Morning, everyone.
Morning.
And welcome to, gosh, it's Sunday the 3rd of March already, isn't it? The year is rushing past. Welcome to our service this morning. And it's good to be here. I'm just waiting for a slide to appear. And there it is. So that's our week ahead of us as mission this week. Pillar talk tomorrow afternoon, and then prayer time on Monday evening. We've also got a leaders meeting on Monday evening as well. That's not on there, but there is. Tuesday is prayer time on Tuesday morning. Wednesday is Lent lunch up at St. Mary's. Also Wednesday, of course, Alpha continues. And then on Thursday, it's Faithful Blend in the morning, Young People's Worship Group in the afternoon, and Curry Club.
Yay!
I was waiting for that. That's at Cafe Bangla. Men, if you want to book your place, have a word with Bill and get it all sorted out. And then on Sunday, we're back here for our next service. Just a few special things I want to mention. One was the fact it's our church business meeting a week on Tuesday. And I repeat, Tuesday, not Wednesday, because Alpha will still be continuing. That's the 12th of March at 7:30. Members, you'll get an email from me very soon, today hopefully, or tomorrow at the latest, with the information in that you need. And also the main thing happening this coming week is LZ7 Illuminate, this very special time for the people of our town. And I was just, when I couldn't sleep last night, I was just reminiscing about the when we were young people in Rushton, when Bill and Hillary and Linda and I were young. And okay, it was 50 years ago, but it was great to be a young Christian person in Rushton that time, because there was a lot of us and it was really special. And my just fervent prayer is just for our young people in our church, in our town, that they can have as special a time 50 years later as we did those years ago. And that's our prayer. There's lots of information about it. In fact, half the news sheet is about it this week. Please grab one, have a look. I don't know how the mobile street signs campaign is going for the folks to stand in along the streets and give directions of the young people how to get to the Baptist church. But if you do want more information, it's on the news sheet. If you want to know more and sign up, then perhaps have a word with Tom. I think he's got his laptop with him again today. So if you need to sign up, you can do that to get set up. And I think that's everything I want to say, other than we'll be taking an offering in our first song as we sing. And the offering, many people do give money directly into the bank. People sort of give it in other ways. So please don't feel it forced as the bag comes around to put money into it. But of course, you know, our offering is a part of our worship and a part of our service to God. Thank you.
So, shall we pray as we begin today? Lord, we come to worship you today. We do come to hear your word. We do come to meet with each other. But most of all, we come to meet with you. So we will pray that you would be present in our worship, that we would forget the people around us and just focus on you and bring you our praise and bring you our love today. Amen.
Your mercy never fails me.
Would you like to be seated, because we're going to have the time of communion next.
Torn myself off. Not your fault. It was all on the preacher. As we come this morning, and could I be torn down just slightly? I want us to be looking at foundations in the Christian faith and what that means to you. And we all may have a different opinion on what foundations are. I'm just reminded as we come to the communion table that the words that God spoke and told Moses to tell the children of Israel when they were coming into the land. When your children ask you, when you're taking Passover and you're meeting, why are you doing this? Like maybe your grandchildren ask you, or our own children ask us. Or maybe you ask yourself, why? Why do we do what we do? God says it's because you are then to remind them to remember of what God did for our ancestors, or what God did for us, and how he delivered us, and how he has led us. And that was looking back at a past event, but I want to remind us this morning, as much as we're also going to look at foundations, it's also the God that's present now, that's at work, who's doing miracles now, who does amazing things now. It's not just a past event. The past event of Passover had an effect also on the present of those who partook of it and remembered. But it wasn't just that God did miracles then. He still does miracles now. There's a part of Scripture that says in Corinthians, he's writing to a church that was in some ways disordered in some things. And thank God 1 Corinthians is written, because it's an encouragement to some of our churches when you see how some of the things that go on in our own midst. But Paul says, look, concerning spiritual gifts, eagerly desire them. Because we're not just here to fulfill rituals and listen to sermons, but we are here to not only also receive God's Holy Spirit, but function in that Spirit. We don't come to church. We gather together as church. And if the Spirit of God is with us, then he should be doing something. And if he's not, we should be seeking him until he is demonstrated in power amongst us. Through the preaching, through the praise, through our prayers, through our sharing, through what we're doing, not just as we gather, but also as we go. That's why when we come to remember communion, we are here to remember what God has done, but also what God still does. Not just what he has done in the past. It's what he has done for you. It's what he can do for someone else, and what he continues to do in your life as you continue to walk with him. Jesus came and gathered and said to the disciples during that Last Supper, given fresh meaning in many ways to that meal that was so familiar and that they took for so long, showing that he ultimately was the Lamb of God, not just for the Hebrew and not just for those who would become proselytes to the Jewish religion, but to those who would believe on him. Not just for them, but he came and gave his life for us and for all those who believe. And as much as we should be rejoicing in our salvation, that salvation also at his leading needs to go out to the nations. And there's some of us here sitting from different nations, all because of not just what he has done, but because the obedience of others that have went and told what Jesus does and can do for them as we receive him. I'm going to ask the helpers to come forward. And as they're coming forward to those that are going to share, I want to invite you who have put your faith and trust in Jesus to this communion table to participate and remember. And as the bread goes around, remember the words that Jesus said, "Take, eat. This is my body that's been broken for you. Take this in remembrance of what he has done for us." Same way Jesus took the cup and he offered it to his disciples and says, "Take this, for this is the symbol of my blood shed for many." As the cup is going to come around, I will ask for those of you to take the cup who are participating and to keep this cup until the end. And then when we all have the cup, we shall take it together. Let us take the cup together. Rather than me pray, if there's a prayer upon someone's heart in a congregation, just shout out your praise or give a word or a sentence of prayer to your Father.
Goodness that your kingdom is offering, Lord, and we declare that your kingdom is come, Lord, and we glorifying your name and worshiping, Lord, for your sacrifice, Lord, that you come to heal us, Lord, you come to give us joy and joy abundant, Lord, and we thank you and we're praising your name for this.
Thank
in Jesus,
Jesus'
name, amen.
Amen. Father, receive the prayer of your saints and of your children. We thank you for what you have done. May we never cease to be amazed at your glory. Amen. Amen. I'm going to invite the vintage group back up. We shall continue to praise the Lord.
How language changes, don't you? Words mean different things over the years. And, we're going to be singing This Is Amazing Grace in a moment. And I was just thinking how the word amazing, the use of it has changed. Because, you know, something's amazing. It fills you with awe and wonder. It's wow. A child might come home from school and say, I've got 10 out of 10 for spellings today, Mum. And the Mum will say, wow, that's amazing. What I mean is, that's really good. You did well. But this is really amazing because of Jesus dying for us and because of what that means for us. That is really amazing. It should leave us stunned in awe and wonder. This is amazing grace. Would you like to stand?
the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. This is amazing grace. This is a that you would take my place, that you would bear my load, you laid down the law, that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
Jesus, I sing.
Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
What you did for us on that cross is amazing. And Lord, we know you did that because you loved us.
Save us, for God so loved the world that he gave us. Jesus is waiting, God so loved the world.
Wow, our God is amazing. Hallelujah. Let's just pray for our young people now as they go out to their groups. Father, we lift our young people to you. Not only the young people in this place, Lord, but the young people of our town today. We are thinking, Lord, of this week when LZ7 are going into schools and they're taking lessons and they're getting to know young people. We're thinking, Lord, of the concerts at the end of the week when all the young people will be invited to come and hear about you and to hear LZ7 play. And Lord, we just pray that you would pour your spirit out today on that group. And Father, that your spirit will be working in the lives of young people, opening hearts, opening minds, to hear about you and to respond. And as our young people now go out, Lord, we just ask that they may be bold to invite their friends to come along to hear about you too. So bless them, Lord, we pray, in the name of Jesus. Amen. It is preparatory. Do you want to play bass? I didn't realise Joe was out in this one. I just think this goes better with a bit of bass in it. It also goes really well if you want to grab an instrument. I know they're at the top of the stairs there, but if somebody got down, if you want an instrument to play or a flag to wave, it's not just children who can praise God in that way. You know, adults can. Anybody who can clap in time. Oh dear, that puts me out. But you're welcome to come again. We're going to sing one that usually the children enjoy. And we're all God's children, so we're going to enjoy it together. We're going to sing praise. I think David was just wondering, actually, which one I was introducing there. Right, shall we stand then? I not get the right song up there. I'll come as soon as I finish this song.
Jean.
No, press card. Sorry. I've always told Mum to ring me if she needed me, so after this song. I'll be disappearing for a while. You not got it?
No.
Have we got the words? Okay, let's cut that song for now then. We'll do it perhaps at the end if they can find the words. We'll sing instead, I Will Worship, which is You Alone Are Worthy of My Praise. Can that one's on. Do you want to lead, Dave? Sorry, folks.
Are we do? Have you got the words for praise? Have the words?
I will worship.
Yeah.
Okay, let's swap. All right.
thingy in it.
Ah, she's got the thingy. Oh.
So, we're not on top of dear old dear. These would not be my chords, because I can't sing really this low, so you're going to have to really pick up and worship, okay? So we're just going to do our best. But I'd have this a little bit higher. I just think as we go, let's just pray for Linda. Father, we just want to just pray for Linda and her mother Jean, Lord, just at this time. Whatever is going on, we just pray that, Lord, you'll be able to take that matter in hand. Father, when these things happen, it shows us that life carries on. It's not all about perfection and having everything happen as we want. That's not how life works. But Lord, meet us in the midst of where we are. Will you just bless us now? And as we just worship, I just encourage you, we're here to worship God. Not just here to follow along, but just let's worship. You know, and if we have to drag the song out, let's just do it. But let's just really just worship and praise our God. I hope I get it right.
Do you want me to sing?
Yes, please. Let us pray. Father, as we just come before you now, Lord. Lord, I just want to pray and ask for your blessing continued upon this time. Lord, I'm not putting trust in a message, Lord, that's being prepared. I'm not putting trust in even the gift or calling, I believe, that you've placed. But, Lord, I'm putting the trust in you for you to do something. And, Lord, for you to have your way. And by your Spirit, Lord. Naturally, we live by the breath that, Lord, we're able to breathe, the air that we have. And for this, we give you thanks. But, God, as Christians, we need your Spirit and we need the power. We need the Holy Ghost to have his way. Lord, we are always inadequate and fall short. But you are more than sufficient. Lord, I want to thank you that you send your Holy Spirit to us when we come and receive of your Son that you sent to redeem us and call us to yourself. But Lord, sometimes we use words and things that maybe we expect everyone to understand. But it's when your Spirit comes that you give us understanding. And Lord, I just pray now at this time, will you speak by your Spirit? Lord, as you anointed the priest in the Old Testament to go forth and to represent you, Lord, as I stand to speak your word, Lord, I just pray that your Spirit will be present with power, not to make me sound good, but to move amongst us. Lord, to empower the message, to bless the message that speaks of you. But Lord, also, that you will speak to each and every heart, as well as the preacher, to hear what the Spirit is saying, to hear what you are saying. We don't want any other spirit, Lord. We don't want anything else. Create in us a hunger after you, God, a real hunger and desire. Lord, and now allow not our pride to stand in the way of receiving of what you have for us, God. But also allow not our sense of inadequacy and unworthiness stand in the way of also receiving the blessing that you want to give us. What a privilege, Lord, to know you. And we won't want to just know you ourselves, but we want others to know you. And so, Lord, we do just pray. Will you even have your way in our lives and in our midst? Create in us a heart that burns and yearns for you and that spills forth with blessing for others that we meet, Lord. We want to see your church grow and your kingdom come. And so, Lord, have your way in our midst. Amen. Thank you, Luke, for getting that up. And Luke, not to put any pressure on you, but if we could get praise, that would be wonderful at the end. But it's you did nothing wrong, people, so great job. Oh, wonderful, man. You're even ahead of the game. I wanted to, and I felt it on my heart, to touch upon foundations of the Christian faith, and hence the reason why I've wanted to put one or two slides up to hopefully aid as a kind of give an introductory talk on foundations. I was reminded of something, of two conversations, in fact. One I won't necessarily refer to, but the person who I had the conversation with, if they listen to this message, will know what I'm talking about. It was in regards to worship this week. The first one was got to do with worship. And worship isn't singing, by the way. It's only a part of what worship is. But a part of it is when we come together, an important part of corporate worship is singing. But so is preaching and listening. So is praising and praying. But the other person will also know who they are. The second conversation I had with someone was this. They were forced to go to a football match against their will and in the freezing cold. They said, I realize though I don't like football, why people go there. And they said they noticed that while in the first half the away supporters were cheering on their team, they noticed the difference it made in the team being cheered on. And in the second half, the home supporters that were much more raised their voices and it also raised the morale of the congregation, of the people. And you know what, I just couldn't help thinking, as we were up there doing our best to play and lead you guys, hearing you sing the praises of God just boosts you. Just makes you get lost for that moment, because that's what we should be doing. And when we begin to praise God, sometimes that actually changes your situation. It's like giving thanks. I think I even gave a message some months ago. Giving thanks is like a secret weapon that you have. But when we choose to praise God, and it is a choice, it just lifts. Because otherwise it feels like you're just singing to a crowd. Because congregation and coming together as church is we are singing the praises of God. You're not being entertained. And the musician always needs to be careful. Their instrument and their playing does not become an idol. The same with anything that we do in the Christian faith. But we're here to sing together. And it was just wonderful. I just wanted that time to continue. Just praising God. But as I said, I want to speak on foundations, and by God's grace, I will do that. Now, I will be opening my Bible just as a text from 1 Corinthians chapter 3. If you wish to open it there, you can leave it open there. But Corinthians chapter 3, and I may skip over to some other verses in different parts of Scripture. But I'll be reading a verse or two from chapter 3. But I wanted to introduce it by saying words that it was once given by a man called Arthur Skevington Wood. Now, is there any Methodists amongst us? Anyone? No? Anyone know the name Arthur Skevington Wood? No. Well, he was a man, let's just say, of previous generations, fairly clearly. But if you were a Methodist, you probably would remember a Methodist of a certain era, because he was a Methodist minister who became a lecturer at Cliff College. And while he was lecturing at Cliff College, he would often say, as I've been told, that on the first day his students would come before him, he would say this: every one of you here that reads your Bible is a theologian. Now, I want you to think about that statement and maybe think, what do you mean by what does a theologian mean? The word theology means the study of God, or you could say the study of the things of God, or seeking to learn about God. But do you realize that when you read your Bible, whether you study it, but if you simply read it regularly, in one way you are beginning to form a view of God, of the world, of ethics, of things according to what you have, forming opinions, and in that way, that's what the work of a theologian is. And whether you study or do a PhD or an MA or a BA or whatever you may do, in everything, when you're reading your Bible, you're beginning to form opinions, and then sometimes your opinions change. And taking that statement in its most primitive meaning is that fact that every one of us that's reading our Bible regularly is forming opinions and views regarding God, the world, sin, all these things. However, here's a warning I want to give. When you become a Christian and you are born again, or you receive of the Spirit, you're born, whatever word you want to use, like a newborn baby that's born healthy, you've got everything available at that point in order to grow up to be a healthy human being. Everything's there. You've been formed, okay, but you need food, you need sustenance, you need nurture, you need that love. You see, being born again or receiving Jesus or following him is not enough, because you need to grow. And this is the thing. When you are hungry, sometimes you'll end up eating anything. Do you ever get that the older you get? Do you know what they often say? Never go shopping on an empty stomach, because you'll end up coming home with twice the shopping that you actually need. And you end up picking the rubbish. You walk by, you don't eat donuts, you start to smell them, you're thinking, man, that really tastes good. you end up consuming stuff that's not going to feed you. It's not going to benefit you. Or even eating takeaway every day of the week. Takeaway is okay. I eat it, you know, once a week. Probably sometimes more than once a week. But eating it every single day, eating it for breakfast, that's a recipe for disaster. That's not something I would encourage anyone to want to do. You see, the importance of even when you come to Christ is getting a good, solid teaching and foundation. And Paul says this in 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 10. By the grace that God has given to me, I lay a foundation as a wise builder, and someone else is building on it. But each one should build with care, for no one can lay a foundation other than the one that is already laid, which is Jesus Christ. You see, the Bible at times uses analogies, and a building is one analogy it uses. Most people would have had an idea, if you were not a builder, what building was about. I have never built anything in my life, you know, got to do with on a building site. I've worked on building sites, I've labored on building sites, I've delivered to building sites, but I've never built from the ground up. But I know what it is and what is necessary, in some cases what's needed to build. But you see, we need the knowledge of what to do in our Christian life and have that foundation if we are to grow and to be successful. And the Bible uses this term foundations in different ways, or building, you could say, in different ways. Two ways that I want to point out is that for us as Christians, we who are in Christ are being built up together. We're being built together to be a place of worship for God. That's what it tells us in Ephesians. You're being built up. You don't do anything other than in following God, but you're being built up together. We're being built up to be, as it is, a temple, a dwelling place for God. Not just as individuals. But the emphasis I want to look upon is us together, what are we building on? You see, the foundation's being laid already. We don't lay the foundation. Jesus is the foundation. And even as it says in Ephesians, he is the cornerstone. But what are we building our foundation? What are we building on the foundation? Because every one of us are building something. Every single one of us is building something. Now, I'm going to ask Luke to take a look at this first picture. To put the first picture up. Can anyone tell me, not what this is, but what the actual name is of this particular thing? Does anyone know? Anyone ever visit the southeast of Ireland? You more or less would have went here. Anyone ever visit Wexford? No, definitely not by the looks of your faces. Well, this here is a lighthouse that was built in Wexford, Ireland, where I grew up. I didn't grow up in the lighthouse, but I did grow up in the Republic of Ireland. You know when that was built? Anyone want to hazard a guess the century when that was built? When do you think it was? 19th. The 19th century?
1860.
That's very specific, okay. Anyone else? Anyone want to hazard a guess? That was built in the 12th century. And it's still standing today. And you can still go and visit it, in fact. Still in use. In fact, less than 100 years ago, people still used to live there with their families that manned the lighthouse. It was built by a Norman who came and settled, occupied Ireland, quite like this stead, came as a mercenary and decided to take the land for himself. But it was built by a knight, in fact, not by him personally, but he ordered the building of it, as many things would have done. But that's been standing since the 12th century, guiding ships in as they came to the harbour, as many lighthouse stores. Can we have the next picture, please? Now, people, you have to know what that is you're looking at now. People know? Say, yeah, that's it. I can see Sandra, your hand was there. You were forced to the call, and Linda got to you there. St. Paul's Cathedral. Do you know what century that was built in? Well, I'm going by the internet here, so please, this isn't from a book. If it's wrong, don't sack the messenger.
1863.
No. No. Anyone want to have a guess? No. It was older than the last century. Apparently. Yeah. Well, as far as what I've been told, and I don't know, I need to check this out as fact, but apparently it was around since the 7th century. Not probably in its original, its finished form, but it was built quite a long time ago. Now, I don't know if I got that date wrong, so, but this next one, I know is not wrong. Let me show the next picture. Anyone know what you're looking inside there? Yeah. Sam is right, it's in Rome. Begins with a P.
It's a Pantheon.
Pantheon. It's the Pantheon in Rome. When you look at that, you can tell that's been well taken care of. But you know what? When that was built?
Probably 2,000 years ago.
It was in the 2nd century. The reason I'm showing you those three pictures is, it's okay, Luke, you can go on to the next one. Just onto the blank one. All of those buildings that you've looked at, there's so many other buildings time and times over. Now, the dates may have been slightly wrong on them, but here's the fact. They are still standing today. And I lived in Coventry when my family and I lived in Coventry. It's interesting that if you go and see the cathedral, you have a bombed-out cathedral, and then you have the new cathedral there. But you know the amazing fact is, whatever reason they chose not to rebuild, the foundation was still there. And you can still walk into the bombed-out cathedral that was bombed out during World War II. They decided to rebuild next to it. But here's the thing. The building may have fallen down due to the bomb damage that had happened. But the foundation still remains the same. The Pantheon built long ago. Roman influence may remain, but the Roman Empire has long, long gone. The Normans have long, long gone. These people of old have gone. The British Empire also, when you look at what they've built, it's also gone. But the remains of those things that were built properly and taken care of remain. I can drive around Ireland and I can drive into places of ruins everywhere. And you can tell that they're not taken care of. But there's these other places that you see. And the reason they still stand is because they had a solid foundation that enabled them to stand. I worked on a building site in a place called Malahide near the coast of Dublin, delivering kitchens. And when I came to England and I spoke to my brother-in-law, who I used to work with in the same factory making the kitchens, who was the manager and then became the boss there, in fact, he told me, "Davey, you wouldn't believe it. Remember the site we delivered to?" I said, "Yes." He says, "The group of those houses needed to be rebuilt and the families needed to be evacuated." I says, "Why?" He says, "Because the rubble, or the gravel and things in the foundation, sorry, the core in the foundation, they used a different supplier. And over the water damage, and when the water came, it caused damage. It caused that core, hardcore, to expand, and the walls to crack, that they had to rebuild the houses. And now the people are suing." You see, the foundation wasn't proper. And therefore, the structure may have been nice, nice overpriced house in an expensive area by the coast. But when the water came and the rain came, it didn't last. It didn't matter what you built up on top. But here's the thing, and let me flip this around. Our foundation can't be any better. But what are we building with? And what are we building on? Paul says this: by the grace of God given to me, I have laid a foundation as a wise builder. And someone else is going to build on it, but each one should take care how he builds. For no one can lay any other foundation than what is already laid, which is Jesus Christ. If anyone builds on this foundation using gold, silver, and costly stones, wood, hay, or stubble, their work will be shown for what it is, because the day will bring it to light. It will be revealed with fire, and the fire will test the quality of each person's work. If what has been built survives, the builder will receive a reward. But if it is burned up, the builder will suffer loss, but yet will be saved, even though only as one escaping through the flames. Every one of us is building something. Every one of us is preparing something. But we need to be careful of what we are building. And to go back to the example I used, as a new believer, when you come, and you can even be an old believer, if you've not had a good foundation. And what I mean is this: if you are not sitting under good preaching, and you're not sitting under good teachers, if you're not getting the right teaching, you are going to get the wrong. Like the analogy I used of not going, when you are hungry, into a fast food place or going shopping, you will end up eating the wrong thing. See, when you become a believer, or when you are a believer, there should be a hunger for God's word. And often, like a young baby, I used to watch Margaret feed the baby when they were younger. And they would drink, especially the boys. The girls were a little bit more a little bit more relaxed, but the boys, they would eat and eat and eat, and they would grow and grow, not up but out. They would have all these fat cheeks, you know, in their first year. If I look back at pictures, I have to see the clothes they're wearing, because I can hardly tell the difference, because they're just fat and plump, because they're drinking, 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 drinking. And then when they got onto solids, dear Lord, they ate and ate and ate. That doesn't really change with boys, by the way. They tend to have a massive appetite. But Paul says, as a newborn baby, hunger after the word. That should never change, but it needs to be the right food that you're getting. You see, a woman, and I know sometimes this is not possible, will naturally produce, if she's able to, the milk herself for the baby to be able to feed upon. And I know now, because some people we all know are not able to feed, but let's just go with the fact that when God does provide, we need to be drinking and feeding upon what he gives us if we are to grow properly. And if we are to grow to be what he wants us to be. And you see, when you begin to grow, then you begin to know and understand. And then you are able yourself to build the life that you have. And like a child, when you first become a Christian, and even as you grow, you're dependent on others sometimes to feed you. But there are other people, and that is still sort of the case as you grow. God puts people in your life to teach you, but then you get to a stage where you're able to discern and grow yourself and feed. And there's two important things I want to bring in here, and it is this: in order to grow, first, you need to be born again, but second, you need the Spirit of God and the Word of God. And without the Word of God and without the Spirit of God, you are not going to grow. See, you can read this Bible all you like as a non-Christian, but until the point of you come to putting your faith in Christ, until you come to the point of being converted, this book will just be a mystery to you. But when you become born again, God gives you his Spirit, and he reveals this truth to you. And it reminds me of when Jesus has been resurrected in Luke chapter 24. If you want, in fact, you can turn to Luke chapter 24 just for a few minutes. And in Luke chapter 24, Jesus has been resurrected, and there's people that are walking on the road. We all have heard about the story if you've been in church for any few years, on the road to Emmaus. He's on the road, he's walking along, he comes alongside, but hides himself, and he listens to these two disciples talking. And he listens to them, and he hears all that they're talking about. And then he says to them, "How foolish are you, and how slow are you to believe all that the prophets have spoken? Did not the Messiah have to suffer these things and then enter his glory? And then, beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he explained to them what was said in the scriptures concerning himself." Notice what Jesus does. He rebukes them, and then he says, "Are you so stupid that you don't know that all through the scriptures that you listen to in your synagogue, that you hear in the temple, that you've known from your childhood, are you so stupid that you do not know this is what was supposed to happen all along?" And you know, when I say that, I often think, God, I'm so stupid, because sometimes I've looked at the scriptures and I've not seen it. Because if all I have is the scripture, you're not going to see it. But when the Spirit of God reveals to you Jesus in the scriptures, that's a whole other thing altogether. There was once a saying by an English man who says, and I'm probably going to misquote this, "If all we have is the Spirit, we'll blow up. And if all we have is the Word of God, we'll dry up. But if you have the Word of God and the Spirit of God together, then you'll grow up." And I think sometimes that's what we both need. And I don't know, I've met Christians that they're all about the Word of God, but man, no mercy. No grace, just the Word. No Spirit, no mercy, no nothing. Just straight Word. It would have been great Pharisees. Great at making you feel miserable. Not great at encouraging you. And then there's the other ones. They're just all about the Spirit. So much so that they'll abandon the Word of God and any principles found in the Word of God. And their beliefs end up all crazy. In fact, I had one man say to me, yeah, I love the Bible, but I love the Spirit. I thought, after listening to him for an hour, I didn't believe in the same Spirit he was talking about. Because it's not the same Spirit that I believe God reveals in the Scripture. But we need the Word and we need the Scripture together. And when we have both of them, then we're able to lay a good foundation of understanding who God is. And we need to take the Bible on its own terms. We need to understand the Bible for what the Bible says about itself. And here's the thing. If you write a book, you've got a challenge. And this is a challenge even for people who teach. You can go up and give loads of people information, but you need to try and convey to them a story that is understood and they're able to follow you. There's no point writing a book and having all these details in it and then someone reads it and think, I have got no clue what I'm watching. Do you ever watch a movie like that? And they're like, what's going on next? What happened there? Why did this happen? Sometimes when you sit with your wife as a man, that's what the situation is like. I've sat down and watched a movie 3 times and thought, no, we actually didn't see this before. Yeah. Well, I'll just pretend that we didn't. But it's, God did not give us a book that we should be approaching like that. What's happening now? What's going on here? He gives us understanding by his Spirit. Even if I was the best teacher in the world, unless his Spirit is indwelling you, then this book remains a mystery. But here's the thing. Not just does the author have that. We have access to the author of the book. See, if you write a book, you know what it's talking about. And if you've got answers and questions, you can go to the author. If there's a book day, or go and visit them, or write to them. But you realize that God had a certain intention in writing his book. And if we want to understand what it says, we have access to the author. You know, one of the functions that he says when God says, I'm going to send you his Spirit, you know, one of the functions he has is to teach us. It's to teach you. He will teach you things. He'll lead you into truth. He'll remind you of things. He, the person of the Spirit, will do this. But what we need to be doing, if we're going to build a foundation, is to be dwelling in the Word, feeding on that Word, trusting in His Spirit, and being led by His Spirit. Now I'm going to ask Luke and round him up to please show the next slide. Now I hope this slide becomes clear. We're going to go back to something to try and make a point. So as it should be self-explanatory, on one side it says 2,000 years ago the Romans built this road and it's still standing. But the second one says 2 years ago this is a modern road. And the reason why I want to use this is if you want a good solid foundation that's going to last, then we need to understand what God says, do what God says, live by what God says, and be led by His Spirit and what God says. But if we want to do things by modern means, then it may look good for a while, but eventually it's going to fall apart. Now, looking at this road reminds me a little bit when I was thinking about this by-election. I'm thinking, well, I don't care who we get, but hopefully they fix the roads in Rushton, because every road I'm driving around, even around where you live, Martin, is even worse, around near Pemberton Centre and Highfield. It's like dodge the pothole. But you see, now I know there might be reasons for this, of why the roads are not filled in and modern means that we have, but the fact is, Roman roads still remain today. Now I know they weren't dealing with Arctic lorries and so on, there can be all excuses, but just go with the image for a minute. There are so many influences that have come into the church, new ways of thinking. But we need to be careful that we are not trying to interpret the Bible according to modern philosophy and our own views. And sometimes we don't realize that through media, through education, you have had all sorts of worldviews impressed upon you. And it's garbage. It's absolute garbage. And sometimes we think, because we've heard it from a pulpit, or heard it from someone we trust, well, it must be true. I'm going to tell you this. The devil is not interested in you going to church. He's not interested in you singing hymns. He's interested in you walking in obedience. He's not even interested if you're just going through your formulaic prayers. He's interested in Christians that are serious about their faith, that are following in the Spirit. He couldn't care less what garbage you listen to once you're not listening to the truth. I told you one time about the dream of an old Puritan that said he had a dream where there was a preacher preaching in the town, in the market. And he realized it was the devil himself preaching the pure gospel. And at the end of it, he went and he approached the devil and says, "Why on earth are you preaching the Bible?" So he says, "I've learned this. To preach the Bible without the anointing of God's Spirit is a sure way of damning people to hell. We're not there to just listen to what we want. We're there to listen to the truth. And the truth as God sends it." And the devil knows the Bible inside out. And he knows exactly how to twist it. And I've learned this lesson. If the devil is going to go after anyone, it's not going to be a preacher like me who's preaching to probably 40, 50 people. He's going to go after big influencers. Big preachers. I'm using a modern word, influencers. As well as influencers in the world. You know why? Because they have got a greater impact. And I can sing from my head without naming names so many great men of God that have gone down into rabbit holes and have led many people to a faith that is now shipwrecked because they have listened to the lies of the devil who came to them like an angel of light and has misled hundreds, in some cases thousands, of people that follow them. I can think of men right now that were strong in the faith that right now are just a ship smashed on the sea. They've adopted all sorts of theologies and all sorts of influences that have got nothing. And it's not just a pothole road. It's a ditch or a cliff that leads to disaster. We need to be careful and watchful and kept in check. But we need to make sure we're building on the right foundation. Now I'm going to close with something I've never used in preaching before, but I think we're all going to know this story, and I think it's good theology. I was going to go somewhere else, but because of time, I'm going to cut it short. And I want to tell you a story that you probably heard as a child, and it's the three little pigs. Remember the story of the three little pigs? Well, I think the three little pigs is great theology. I'm going to tell you why. Because if you remember the crux of the story, the three little pigs built properties, didn't they? It was one of straw, I think, one of stick, something like that. And the last one was of brick. But here's the thing. They all went off and did their own thing. And they all built a nice little home. And they were happy in the home until the wolf came along. Remember the huff and the puff? I'll blow your house down. Like, yeah, yeah, yeah. Well, he blew on the straw and the straw blew away. He blew on the sticks and the sticks blew away. But he could not huff and puff and blow down the house that was not only built on a solid foundation, but was built with the right materials. And as Christians, we need to know what to do with the materials. I know if I walk in to a builder's yard, I know what everything is just about. But I don't have the skill and the mindset to know how to put all those things together. I know what I may need, but I don't know how to build it all. But God does. And he gives us what we need, and he raises up what we need. But we need to be careful that if we have built a bad foundation, that we are open to say, God, help me. If I'm building maybe with wood, hay, and straw, I'm not there to point that out to you. But I'm going to ask God by his Spirit that he will point it out to us. Because we all have the same materials available to us. But are we building with the precious things that God gives? Because what you're building is going to be tried by fire. The Word of God says you'll be saved. Yes, you will. But what you've done is absolutely worthless. And if we, like the first pig, built with straw, it's going to be blown away. If you build with sticks, it's going to be blown away. And to bring it back to the Bible, just like Jesus said about the wise and the foolish builder, if you build on sand, doesn't matter how great and costly those materials are, it's going to collapse. Because I think every one of us sitting here knows life is going to throw all sorts of things at you. But those who are built on the rock, no matter how nervous you feel or how shaky you may be or how badly you go through it, God will see you through it because you're standing on that solid foundation. That is Jesus. There's no other foundation there. And I want to pray for you as I close. I'm not going to ask the group, but I want to close with a prayer. Father, I want to pray for each person here, Lord, including myself. Lord, I am no different to anyone else that is here. But I want to pray that, Lord, will you begin to unveil to us, Lord, the truths of your scripture. Begin to give us a fresh hunger for you and for your word, Lord. We thank you, Jesus, that you are that solid foundation. You are, as even is called, the Word of God. But that through you we have access and have been brought into the family of God. But that, Lord, will you show us how to build, how to grow. Lord, I pray, will you pour out your Spirit on us and give us wisdom and discernment. Lord, a gift I often never hear people pray for is the gift of discernment. And Lord, I want to pray, will you just move afresh upon us by your Holy Ghost even now? Touch us, unveil our eyes. Give us discernment. Give us a hunger for you and for your truth, for your word. And Lord, to see the manifestation of your Spirit in truth. Father, I just pray now, will you begin to touch hearts? Just touch the people as they're here, Lord. Lord, you tell us these things that we may have not only a solid foundation, but use the right materials. And as we begin to look into your word, may the mirror of your word show us what we are. But Lord, may you, most importantly, be formed in us. But Father, I just pray that by your Spirit, touch us afresh. Fill us up, Lord. Lord, I want to pray for the people of this church, whether they've been able to be present this morning. Whatever they're going through, you're with them. You will stand with them. Those who may feel, my faith isn't strong enough, Lord, will you give them the gift of faith now? Those who may feel, God is my foundation right, Lord, may they know that if they're standing and trusting in you, they could be in no safer place. You are their refuge. Father, I want to pray for anyone, whatever they may be going through, if they're feeling wounded right now. If life has not treated them well, maybe they're not feeling strong. Lord, I just want to pray, will you heal them? Restore them. Whether it's emotional or physical damage, whether it's even spiritual abuse, Lord. Lord, I want to pray that each person that is here, that will listen online or whoever it may be, Lord, will they begin to hear your still small voice in your direction? And may they have this confidence that, Lord, you will show them what to do. You will equip them with everything they need. That's what Peter says. God has given us everything that pertains unto life and godliness. Will you help them to know how to access it and to apply it, Lord? To ask questions. Bring those people and influences into their life. But bless them and take care of them. May they know your love. For this I ask in your name, Jesus. Amen. Amen. I'm going to ask the worship group to come back up. And hopefully we will finish with prayers and something else.
So did you find praise? Did you sing this one as well? Yeah. In that case, we've got two songs to sing. So we're going to sing Holy Overshadowing first. Oh, do you want to sing praise first and finish on Holy Overshadowing? I was going to go out with a band, but we'll sing praise first. We'll sing praise, why not? Or I might go the opposite way. I'll just confuse everybody.
I've no idea.
There's nothing like being slick, is there? Would you like to stand?
Thank you.
And we will sing to praise to finish with. So you can grab your flags now and your instruments.
I praise you in the valley.
Praise
on the mountain. I praise you when I'm sure. Praise when I'm doubting. Praise when I'm numbered, praise when surrounded. This praise is the waters my enemies drown in. As long as I'm breathing, I've got a reason to praise the Lord for my soul. Cause you're sovereign, praise cause you reign.
Praise, cause you rose and defeated the grave. Praise, cause you're faithful. Praise, cause you're true. Praise, cause there's nobody greater than you. Praise, cause it's a offering. Praise, cause you made me. Praise, cause you rose and defeated the grave. Now praise, cause you're faithful. Praise, cause you're true.
And worship to you. So as we go, as we leave this place, we pray that we may take with you that sense of your presence, that your spirit might go before us, go with us, and Lord, that we might hold on to your word that you've given us and build our lives on that. Amen. Amen. Amen.